I'm Irene Tompkinson, and this is the third of a 7-part video series that I'm doing as a gift to you to help you with two things. One is to help you to learn some journaling skills or some ways in which to journal. I feel that's one of the most important growth tools that any of us can have, because what it's free. I mean, even if you don't have paper, you can write on a brown paper bag, which is what I did as a kid with drawings because I came from a very poor family. But for anyone, anywhere in the world that's watching this, journaling can happen with just the crummiest piece of paper and a pencil or a pen, a crayon, a magic marker. When you journal, what you're doing is you're having a conversation with you. I taught in the first two videos how there are 4 basic kinds of journaling. One is to just let whatever's going on in your head just flow, flow, flow. Another is to ask questions, because we're constantly asking questions in our life, and to be answering that question from deep within you. Doesn't have to have sentences. You don't have to worry about punctuation. You can just be writing thoughts or stream of words, whatever's coming around in your brain. The fourth is to send letters that you don't mail, but letters that you write to someone about things you want to say or hear yourself say, have a discussion with them, let it all out. You don't mail them. You just dump them is what you do. The journal's the best place in the world for dumping. The fourth is to have a dialogue where you go back and forth with whatever you're going on, what's going on in your head. Can very often be a younger part of yourself. If it is a younger part of yourself and you're journaling, it really helps to hold your pen in your non-dominant hand. And we're going to talk about that one today. That's the kind of journaling that I'm going to share with you today on a how-to. So that's one thing I want to teach you with these videos. But the overall encompassing thing that I want to teach you with the videos is to fall in love with the ta-da that's inside of you. And when I say ta-da, what I'm talking about is the light that you are, the light that you came to this planet with, the special gifts that are inside you, the part of you that is only you. No one else brought that with them. And you know, like they say, you don't want to die with the song inside you. You don't want to die with, you don't want to leave this planet without having shared the gifts that you are. So that's my life mission. I'll tell you how I got on that mission. When I was young, I was one of the kids in the neighborhood that loved all the little kids. I was like the child whisperer. People would ask me to babysit. I just love little ones. And I didn't realize until I was older what it was about. For me, it was so much about the fact that little ones were just such pure joy and curiosity. If they hadn't been hurt, if they weren't living in fearful or unsafe situations, they just had this bubbleness about them, the life force that was so palpable to me to watch. Anyway, that's always been my thing. I always thought that what I was going to do with my life was probably have a couple of daycare centers, because my first degree was in early childhood education. And then as it unfolded in that early childhood education, I worked with a lot of special needs kids. I directed a special needs daycare center when I first finished undergraduate school. And that's where you could see how quickly kids could lose touch with the specialness of themselves and started to feel and believe the stories from their experiences that somehow they weren't okay. The 3 things a child needs, and you were one of them, you needed this, were time, attention, and direction. That's what kids need. They need time, attention, and direction. That's how they recognize their own valuableness and their own worthiness. If there's any of those 3 that, or a combination of the 3 that they're not receiving, or they're receiving it in a negative way, then what happens is they start telling themselves wrong, that they start telling themselves that they're wrong. Here's why they do that. If you ever see a child in a grocery store, you know, like a little one, like a three-year-old, and they get lost from their parents, and you can see the parents are close by, but the kid can't see the parent, and you see the horror and the fear that the child gets. The reason the child gets that is intuitively they know that their life is dependent on that person. And when they lose contact with that person, they feel incredibly, incredibly threatened. I mean, very, very early, kids get that. Because for a child, the God of their world is their caregiver. That's who they believe God to be. The mom, the dad, the grandparents, whoever it is that is responsible for them. And if that person is not able to give them quality time, quality attention, and quality direction, then they believe that there's something wrong with them, that the God of their understanding no longer loves or cares about them, that they've made a mistake somehow, they've done something wrong. Obviously, this is subconscious. What a child does subconsciously is they try to make themselves better, smarter, nicer, funnier, cuter, whatever. They work really, really hard to please this God. And if this God does not get pleased because things don't change, then the kid gets more and more a sense of, I did something wrong. And then that turns into, I am something wrong. The ta-da never left the child. Your ta-da never left you. It's there. It's the light that you are. It's the place where your laughter comes from. It's the place where your genius comes from. Your problem solving comes from. It's the place where your creativity comes from. It's the place that opens up when you hear wonderful music. You've had moments when you've been there with it. It's there and you know it's there, but we have such a hard time staying in touch with it because we're so busy with the brain working on all the stories that we believe about ourselves. If I was smarter, if I was stronger, if I was prettier, if I made more money, if I spent my money better, if I kept the house cleaner, if I did whatever, then somehow I'd be pleasing whatever the big forces are, because now as we grow older, that God becomes some God outside of us or some force outside of us. I'm hoping this makes sense to you. Anyway, to help you get in touch with those conversations that you have in your head, those stories that go round and round and round, and they usually boil down to about 5 or 6 stories that we keep going all the time. And if you think about, if you get conscious about your thoughts, you're not, you know, the middle of the night when you can't sleep, you're not having a whole lot of creative different thoughts. You're having probably the same 5 or 6 thoughts again and again, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Honest to God, it really, really works. If you take a piece of unlined paper and you just flow those thoughts out, get out of bed and flow those thoughts, you won't need the Ambien. You won't need the medication. What you'll do is you'll organically move that out and start to right size it all. That's called the flow writing. That's the writing that I taught about in the first video. The second video was to tell you to write out all the questions that are going on in your head. Like, how am I going to pay the mortgage? Or how am I going to make that relationship work better? How am I going to undo that argument that I had? How am I going to get along with the people at work? You know, whatever. We all have those questions we're asking and asking and asking. Where am I going to go when I die? What is this pain in my foot about? Just write it and write it and write it, okay? So today, this little journaling exercise is about having a dialogue with you. So I want you to think about, so I'm just doing this as a prompt for you to encourage you to write, because so many people have said to me, well, you say journal, but I don't know what that means, or you know, my doctor said you ought to journal, or my other therapist said you ought to journal. So what is this journaling? It's just writing the thoughts. I'm saying it again and again and again. The thoughts that are going on in your head that are causing you to feel agitated, that are causing you to feel anxiety, that are causing you to feel less than. So look inside yourself and say, what's a core scene that I have, say maybe something I was embarrassed about as a kid, or a move that we made as a family that I didn't want to do, or an argument I had with my mom or my dad, or something I witnessed that I didn't want to see. Start a dialogue between you right now, however you are, old you are, right now in this moment in time, with that younger part of you that had that experience. So I'm going to do this. I'm going to give you 3 minutes. I'm going to write along with you. And then I'm going to stop it. I'm going to ask you another question. And then we're going to write another 2 minutes. So whatever scene comes up for you, you're going to write a dialogue with that part of you from the past. Ready, set, go. Okay, that was 3 minutes. So I'm gonna give you another little prompt. And this is the way that can maybe help you a little bit with whatever the dialogue was. So this prompt is, you've stopped writing right now. So this prompt is, you as the person you are right now today, write into the conversation how you feel about what happened. You know, the disappointment, the regret, the gratefulness, whatever you feel about what happened, and offer some compassion to that part of yourself. Okay, I'm going to give you 2 minutes for this one. Okay. So I'm going to just take a deep breath. I should have reminded you to do that while you were writing. I had to remind myself. Because this feels a bit awkward for me doing it while I'm being filmed. So the person that I wrote to was myself at about 21 years old. I was in my first marriage and I had two babies at the time. One was two and one was one. So that's the young Irene. She says, they offered me a scholarship to the Conservatory of Music. Walter said, no, I couldn't go. Me, that's me for right now today, the 72-year-old. You listened to him? Young Irene, yes. Me, why? You always questioned what he said. Why did you listen? The young Irene, I think I was afraid of not being good enough. Me, you didn't know how to be, you didn't know how to be a beginner? I know. I always thought I should know things before I got there. And then we stopped. So the me now today, talking back to her, kind of summarizing. You were so very immature and overwhelmed. You knew the marriage needed to end. You had to survive. Going for voice lessons was so out of the box for you at that time. You had two babies. How could you do it all? So how do I feel about this? I mean, I've obviously looked at this stuff in the past and I've had some real sadness about it. And it feels, in this moment, it feels a bit comforting to tell myself, to give myself some slack and to give myself a break. So I let myself breathe. The purpose of me sharing this with you is not to tell you this is how to do it, but to show you this is a way to do it. And I can't tell you how much journaling has changed my life and all the direction of my life. It's caused me to have an awareness about myself that I've been doing it for 35 years, so probably 38. And it's caused me to grow in ways I never ever would have grown without it. It's a way in which I've been my own clergy, my own priest, you know, my own confidant. And it's not that I haven't shared it with others. And we do need other people in our lives to share stuff with. But it's really important that we have that conversation with ourselves and we work through those layers that stand on top of the ta-da. Because at the end, I want you to know how to go, ta-da! Yes, I matter, and yes, I count. So see you next time.